So in chronic bronchitis, the problem basically is that we have irritants which lead to inflammation, which lead to the production of mucus, which leads to all the problems in lung function. Actually, let's write that, lung function. Things like not getting enough oxygen, not being able to breathe out. So if that's our theme, then it makes sense, right, to think of it one by one. At each of these points, what can we do to treat it? So irritants first, obviously to remove the irritant would be the best. So first with irritants, of course, to remove the source of irritation would always be the best and first thing that should be thought of. And I'm drawing a cigarette here. No matter how much I sound like a broken record, quitting smoking is hugely important to chronic bronchitis because it's the only thing that stops the source of the disease from getting worse. Everything else here is just treating symptoms, but stopping the smoking actually stops the progression of the disease. So I really want to throw that out there as our first thing to think about in treatment. And of course, other sources of irritants can lead to chronic bronchitis, right? A major source for chronic bronchitis, especially in some parts of the world, is pollution. And this one is very hard to treat, especially for one person. I mean, you can't stop your city from being polluted. So aside from moving, there's not much that can be done usually. Sometimes there's occupational exposures, like things to coal or to asbestos, depending on what this person works. And of course, we can always promote healthier work environments, trying to protect themselves with masks or other things. But as of right now, these are still very high risk jobs for chronic bronchitis. And of course, we can have allergens. So this, the person can have some control over. If you know what kind of allergens are irritating, you can try to stay away from that as much as possible. So just decreasing all of these and stop irritating the lungs is the first step to treating chronic bronchitis. Okay, so given that this has already happened, we're treating the symptoms. Inflammation is the body's response to irritants. And in the lungs, part of that response makes the muscles in the walls of the lungs spasm, and that's how we get the cough, and also the airways narrow as part of the inflammation. So if we draw a cross section of the airway here, we're looking down the tube like this. And usually in a non-irritated lung, the lumen here might be about that wide. This is smooth muscle and just different things, layers of the wall. There's glands, there's connective tissue. Okay, this is how a lung usually looks like, but when it's being irritated, it spasms and the lumen gets so small like this, and it's hard for air to get through. So all of these muscles are spasming and the walls are getting thicker like that. And in our case, there's going to be some mucus in the lumen as well, clogging it up. So one important way to treat this is we'll write this as a bronchodilator. So we already know that broncho refers to the lungs, bronchodilator. And this basically just opens the airway back up. So the bronchodilator helps us go from this to this. Now there are different classes of drugs that all qualify as a bronchodilator because all that means is just opens the airway back up. So one important class is a beta 2 agonist. An agonist means it activates this receptor. Beta receptors are part of the fight and flight response that our body has, and there are beta receptors all over the body, including in our hearts. And then there are our eyes. So during fight and flight, our pupils get bigger so we can see a little better. And of course, since we're talking about this right now, it's also part of the lungs. And in the lungs, it just opens up the airway like we talked about just now. Another class is the anticholinergics. So instead of agonists, these are antagonists, cholinergic. That just means it goes against what the cholinergics usually do. Now this is a completely different pathway, but it does the same thing of opening up the lumen of the airway so we can get more breath in and the lung can be less inflamed. So another completely different class of anti-inflammatory drugs are the steroids and the leukotriene inhibitors. So up here, the bronchodilators really just treat the symptom of inflammation. Let's write that here, the symptom. But down here, when we bring out the steroids and the leukotriene inhibitors, these are the big guns that actually go to the actual site of the inflammation and stop it there. So how inflammation works in our body is that there's a trigger, so T for trigger, and it goes through a cascade, one leads to another. So we have A leading to B, leading to C, leading to D, dot, 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 all the way. The last step is a leukotriene. We've reached the end, inflammation cascade. Inflammation has started and it will keep going. So of course the leukotriene inhibitor is here. It just gets rid of the last step, the product of this whole cascade. So it tempers down the inflammation. The steroids are earlier, say in step C. The steroids come in and stop the cascade earlier here. Now I put a slash here, but do not confuse them for being similar to each other or being interchangeable. They're completely different, but I had them together here because they both target the cascade of the inflammation and stops it at the root instead of just going for the symptom of it like a bronchodilator. Okay, let's keep going with our process here. Now for the mucus, you might imagine that since they cough so much and that must be very uncomfortable, that we might give cough suppressants to these people. You've probably seen it over the counter, it stops you from coughing. And it's important to remember that for chronic bronchitis, we do not do the suppressants because the mucus is already there. We want it to come out. So again, we have our airways here and it's coated by there's too much mucus here and we don't want it. Let me use a blue color because it's kind of a liquid. Okay, here's all the mucus and we cough all day long. That's uncomfortable, yes, but imagine if we gave them the suppressant and they no longer cough it up. This would just be full of mucus, all clogged up. This would actually be horrible for the patient. Because the more clogged we are, the more we can have bacteria behind it. We'll have pneumonia, other infections. So we really don't want that. So as much as it's uncomfortable to cough, unfortunately, most of the time, for productive coughers, we need to let them keep coughing. But we can go through these other treatments to go down on the inflammation. Maybe they won't make as much mucus to try to solve the problem that way. And lastly, we have to deal with the fact that the lungs are not getting enough oxygen. These people are called blue bloaters, right? Because they have lower oxygen in their blood because the airways are so narrow and there's mucus, so oxygen doesn't get through as well. So we might think, okay, let's give them oxygen. Nowadays, it's easy enough to do that in the hospital, so or at home, oxygen. But I really want to put that in parentheses because, yes, a lot of people get this, but in some patients, especially very sick patients, we have to be very careful about giving them oxygen, and here's why. And here we have to talk about the issue of the breathing drive. I mean, you don't have to think about breathing all day long, right? That's because something in your brain automatically tells us to breathe. This is there when you're asleep. It's a very powerful drive. And it's important to remember that in most people, let's say their O2 level is about this high. Their carbon dioxide level will be about this high. It's going to be lower. And that differential is there. So remember that oxygen goes in the blood during a breath. And when you breathe out, the CO2 comes out. So if you're not breathing, the CO2 goes up and the oxygen comes down. If you or I stop breathing, it is the fact that our CO2 would go up that signals our body and our brain that, we're not breathing, and the breathing drive kicks in. So in a person without bronchitis, it is this fact that the CO2 is going up that makes us breathe, that signals our brain and our body that, okay, we need to keep breathing, we need to get that gas out of there. So CO2 controls the breathing drive in people who don't have chronic bronchitis. Okay, so this is healthy, H for healthy. Now let's look at people with chronic bronchitis. What happens is that their O2 level is lower to begin with, and their CO2 level is higher than normal, so like that. So the CO2 being high no longer makes them breathe, drive them to breathe. It is the fact that this O2 is low that controls their breathing drive. So if we give them oxygen here, this can actually take away the breathing drive by giving them too much oxygen. The body will think, because it's usually relying on the oxygen to breathe. So with extra oxygen, that drive might go away, and this person can actually stop breathing, especially when they're having a bad episode of chronic bronchitis. So oxygen, it is used, but it can be dangerous, and it should be used with caution, and this person should be monitored to make sure that they're still breathing. And lastly, I just want to mention that if a person has an acute episode, which is when the disease gets really bad, we will treat them aggressively with steroids, yes, but one other thing we want to add are antibiotics, because they might have an infection. If they have it, we treat it, and they don't, we want to prevent it, because the extra mucus during an acute exacerbation can keep the bacteria in the lungs. So we really want to get on top of that and make sure that we don't develop pneumonia on top of bad chronic bronchitis. So here, in a nutshell, are the most common treatments for chronic bronchitis. As you can see, most of it is symptomatic, which means we don't get rid of the root of the problem. Remember, to go back to the beginning, whatever we can do to reduce the irritation to begin with will be the best thing for the patient in the long term.